Regina did her both master degree and PhD degree in the Technion. And then she moved on and did two postdocs, one with the National Research Council of Canada and another one in the Weizmann Institute, before she joined us to the department. And now Regina is a faculty member here in the department. Her research focuses on the development of advanced numerical models and theoretical solutions for a very wide range of problems applicable for a very wide range of scientific problems engineered from the fields of geology, geophysics, geochemistry, and all kinds of different interdisciplinary tasks, which non-linearity and interplay between different physical scales and parameters take place. And I need to say that I'm working with Regina, and it was always a pleasure to come with a problem. We had a geochemical sedimentological problem. We couldn't explain the results, and we developed with Regina a model that could really give us some more understanding of the natural processes that are happening. So just to sum up, her research interests are natural gas migration in aquatic sediments, geodynamics, earthquakes, submarine slope stability, localized volume reduction patterns in rocks like cracks, stylites, and compaction lines. So you're welcome. I'm not sure what to say.
Okay, hello everyone. The title of the talk is A Methane Bubble Ascent Within Shallow Muddy Aquatic Sediments, Dynamics and Controlling Factors. This work has been done with Shahrazad Arbour-Sirhan and in cooperation with Ilya Ostrovsky and Itzhak Makovsky and Uri Ten Brink at our School of Marine Geosciences. Gassy sediments abundantly found in the continental margins worldwide is a source of the permanent concern for their contribution for the stabilization of marine, aquatic, and the coastal infrastructure, air pollution, and the global warming. Here, for instance, in this acoustic publication, you can see a gassy layer with well-defined gas horizon. And this gassy layer is consisted of bubbles, gas bubbles, which are discrete bodies of immiscible gas in the surrounding media. And what you can see here is a well-defined horizon, and the bottom boundary of this layer you don't see clearly. Okay? I will concentrate on the gassy muddy aquatic sediments and the bubbles within muddy aquatic sediments. And these sediments typically are uncemented, clay-bearing, that means that they are cohesive, and fine-grained. Grain size is smaller than 100 microns. Although, of course, sandy sediments can also contain free gas. Three recent experimental developments allowed researchers to collect enough information about the bubbles inside cohesive sediments. The first one is application of X-ray computed tomography or CT scanning to view bubbles within natural sediment samples. This is in this method you can see separate bubbles. The second one is the acoustic imaging of gassy sediments that permitted their general characterization. And the third one is single bubble growth experiments in the lab, in the sediment sample or in the gelatin, which is a muddy sediment surrogate for its properties. And these experiments allowed obtaining information about the bubble parameters like size, width, volume, and other parameters. So just for the beginning, I will list the processes affecting gaseous CH4 dynamics within shallow aquatic sediments. What you can see here is the profile of methane concentration taken from this paper in the core taken from the sediment of the Eckernförde Bay in the Baltic Sea. Here you can see depths, for instance, from 0 to 8 meters. And we can look, for instance, here for this methane concentration profile. So first two processes are bacterially mediated methane production, which is methanogenesis, and consumption. For instance, if you are looking here, then methane production from organic matter takes place somewhere here at the depth from 6 to 8 meters. And methanotrophy, which is a zone where methane disappears, is a zone where methanotrophic bacteria live, takes place at some distance below the sediment water interface. And you can see here that in most of the cases, methane, the bubbles of methane and also the concentration of the dissolved methane does not approach the sediment water interface and neglects approximately at methanotrophic zone, at sulfate methane transition zone. So here, these are two bacterially mediated processes. The third process is phase transition of methane between gaseous and aqueous phases. So when the concentration of methane, like here, exceeds the solubility line, this is the solubility line, which in turn is affected by the temperature, pressure, salinity, and other factors. Then methane bubbles form. For instance, here methane bubbles form and try to migrate toward the sediment water interface driven by their buoyancy. That means that methane forms here, then under some conditions bubbles also form, try to migrate towards the interface, and in the most of the cases they stop due to the methanotrophy below the sediment water interface. And all these processes are strongly affected by physical and chemical conditions in the sediment. So much of the free shallow gas near the sediment water interface is generated by the microbial decomposition of organic matter, which is a biogenic methane in the absence of the dissolved oxygen and sulfate. But of course, among these biogenic bubbles of the methane can be, under some conditions, some other bubbles that stem from thermogenic methane or methane hydrates. Okay? So when we are talking about the buoyancy-driven bubbles migration, this is, for instance, the example how these bubbles can migrate toward the sediment water interface. Okay, bubbles in different sediments are very different, and according to Anderson, three general classifications exist. The first one, type one, you can see here, yellow are the bubbles, blue is the water, and the black are, yellow are sediment grains, blue is the water, and black are the small bubbles. And these small gas bubbles share a common porous space with water between the grains. Type two bubbles, when bubbles, this one, the bubbles fill the void space between the number of grains and displace only pore water, but they, these bubbles do not displace the grains, okay? And these bubbles are typical for coarse grain sediments like sands. And type bubbles of the type 3 are these very large bubbles that actually displace not only the pore waters, but the grains from the initial position in the porous media. And this type of the bubbles is dominant in very fine-grained cohesive sediments, which are muds. So I showed you in the beginning three methods that allow to get information about the bubbles within the sediment. And what you can see here is the core. And in this core, you can see the intercalated layers of sand and mud. Here is white is sand and the gray is mud. Okay. And here you can see two kinds of the bubbles. This is a small bubble, small spherical bubble, which is typical for coarse grain sands. And here are much larger bubbles, which are typical to muds. Okay? So, and these bubbles are elliptical or disc-shaped. They are much, much taller, and they have another shape than this spherical bubbles, which are typical to the mud. Okay, and these bubbles in the mud can be approximated by the oblique spherules. So, how these bubbles grow? For instance, this is the experiment on the bubble growth within the sediment. This is the core. A specimen of the muddy, fine-grained muddy sediment, and the straw was inserted into the sediment, and the methane was injected into this sediment. Okay, and what was seen is that the growing in the muddy sediment, the bubble initially fills the adjacent pore space, and then starts deforming the surrounding sediment skeleton. So, and what you can see here, you can see the large mature bubble that is even comparable in its size with a sediment sample. And we can say that it is maybe cornflake shaped or disc shaped large bubble, which is much larger than the grain size, okay, of this sediment. This is another lab, also lab experiment of bubble growing and propagating in the gelatin. And the gelatin is a transparent material that possesses a mechanical properties that are similar to the muddy sediment, the Young's modulus, structure toughness, porosity ratio, and others. And here you can see an example of the bubble propagating in the gelatin. This is a buoyancy-driven migration. Okay, so with respect to the bubble growth and propagation mechanism, okay, some group, Johnson from 2002, they, in the similar experiment, they tried to track the pressure evolution within the bubble. And so pressure evolution in the bubble growing in the sediment and also in the gelatin. And here is the pressure. This graph is pressure in the bubble growing in the sediment, and this is the pressure growing in the gelatin. And what is seen that the internal pressure within the bubble shows a sawtooth pattern here and also here. And this pattern is expected if the tested sediment responds to an increment of the pressure within the growing bubble in an elastic manner, and then eventually fails by fracturing. For instance, when the methane, the gas, is injected into the bubble, then elastic expansion occurs up to some threshold, and then the fracturing of the bubble at its envelope occurs, and the pressure drops down, and this is a fracturing increment. Okay? And this sawtooth pattern cannot be associated neither with plastic or with fluid-like response. That means that although this mud or gelatin, they are very soft and maybe fluid-like, but this a response, sawtooth pattern on the pressure evolution is characteristic only for the solid and not for the fluid. And that means that actually this sediment and also its surrogate gelatin are not the fluids, but the fracturing elastic solids. So another proof that actually this muddy sediment is a solid are the experiments of bubbles growth and release from the cores. For instance, here you can see the experiment of the bubble growth and the buoyant migration, that after the bubbles left the specimen, you can see what is left are just the localized fractures. You see that bubbles were grown just in some specific location, and when they propagated towards the top of this core, they left the signs, the footprints of the localized fractures. So that recent laboratory simulations of gas bubble growth in gelatin and mud suggests that muddy sediment does not respond mechanically either as a fluid or a plastic solid during the bubble growth and migration, but rather as a fracturing elastic solid. And because this is the mechanical behavior of this sediment, and this is the reason why you see here just localized fractures. Okay? So, and what is the reason for this behavior? Only in muds, for instance, in fine-grained cohesive muds, and not in sands. So, if you are looking to this picture, then you see the grains, and you see the two fluid system. Okay, for instance, this is a gas, and this is a water. Okay, and if you maybe go to the course of flow in the a porous media, you can see that there is there is a curved interface between gas and between the water in the porous space. Okay, this is the reason for this. In any place, curved interface is the surface forces. Okay, surface traction. And that means that if you measure the pressure on both sides from this interface, for instance, in gas and in water, you will realize that this pressure is very different. So in gas, here, because you have a curved interface, the pressure is much larger than in the water. Okay? And if you want your gas to migrate or to, for instance, to transport due to the buoyancy, that you want it to invade to the next pore slot, something placed between the grains. And this invasion occurs so the gas can propagate if the difference between the pressure of gas and the pressure of water is larger than some specific value that has a name of the capillary entry pressure, and for instance can be specified by this analytical expression. So if the pressure in the gas is larger than the pressure in the water by this value, then the water will invade to the next pore. If it is smaller, then it will stay in place. And if you look here, for instance, then this is the grain size, grain radius. And if the grain size is large, Okay, then this, all this part is very small. Okay, and the pressure within the gas can be just a little bit larger than the pressure within the water. And gas this invade to next pore slot in any place where it wants, and it will not push the grain apart because its pressure will not be too different from the pressure in the water. But in any case, when you have a very small grain size, okay, then you can look here, then this value will be very small and all this part will be large. Then the gas will invade with such a large pressure, okay, then in its way all the grains will be pushed apart, okay, and the cohesion between these grains will be broken. For instance, cohesive organic matter, the bonds between these grains will be broken. And this is the initiation of the localized fracturing, okay? And this is the reason why you see here actually the places of the broken cohesion between the grains. And why gas propagating in the muddy sediments leaves just localized fractures. Okay, just some additional insights about the mechanical behavior of the muddy sediments. For instance, these guys noted that muddy sediments can fracture, although they are very soft. Okay, and the mechanical behavior can be described by a fracture mechanics as in any other fracturing materials. And if we will apply this theory to the muddy sediment, then the main parameter of the fracture mechanics, its name is fracture toughness. And in our case, applicable for the muddy sediment, it will measure the ease of breaking the bonds in muddy sediments between the grains, which can be electrostatic, organic, water-based, and other bonds. For instance, in contrast for some sandstone, where these bonds, for instance, are in general cementation between the grains. But in the muddy sediments, in cohesive muddy sediments, the bonds are maybe electrostatic, organic, water-based, and others. Okay? Some other systems where fluid flow is accompanied by the fracturing. In petroleum systems, it is the hydrofracturing. For instance, in geodynamics, it's magma emplacement and dikes propagation. Or again, in the petroleum system, it can be low permeability rock charging, which is also accompanied by the localized fracturing. Okay, so then the objectives of this study.
Excuse me, one second.
Can
you say a few words about? You describe this and you show how the pressure increases and now we get fracture within the sediment.
Yeah.
And you say something about the implication on the mechanical strength of the entire sediment and the total pressure.
No, it's very different. You will see it is in the end.
Okay.
I will say it in the end, okay? Okay, so to build a numerical model that will include reaction transport, solid mechanic components applicable for bubble growth, then to simulate the bubble growth prior to its rise, to track the bubble shape and size evolution, and to evaluate the bubble shape and size and its dependence on the sediment properties. So this all objectives are related to the first project. And this is the new objective. So this is project of the bubble growth, and this objective, which is to simulate the bubble propagation path and to get insights onto the main controls, is related actually to the bubble migration toward the sediment water interface. I will describe you in brief the model. So this bubble, this is the initial seed of the bubble. The dimensions, of course, are different. Okay, this is bubble head, and this is a bubble tail, which is placed by one of its surfaces onto the surface of the sediment box. And what we are simulating, the first equation is a solute conservation equation. It is formulated for the dissolved methane in the porous space in the sediment box. Okay, you can see here the diffusive component and also the chemical reaction component that can be responsible for methane generation by methanotrophy and methane methane generation by methanogenesis and methane consumption by methanotrophy. Okay, so this is a diffusion, and this is the reaction of production and consumption of the methane. And this is what happens around the bubble in the porous space of the sediment. Again, in the region outside the bubble, this is a force equilibrium equation, the elasticity, which shows you the elastic displacement, solves for the elastic displacements, which includes, which is very important, the gravity. So the gravity is also included in this equation. The next part is the conservation of gas within the bubble. So this is the rate of change of gaseous methane within the bubble, how this mass of this gas changes with time. And this change depends on the diffusive flux through this bubble surface. Okay, and for instance, if we cut this configuration through the bubble and look from this size, then without the gravity, you will see such an elliptic bubble. Okay, and then from the solute transport, you link the solute transport, which relies on the concentration of the gaseous methane on the pressure of within the bubble, which is actually the link with the solid mechanics part. So the pressure of the bubble is applied as a boundary condition on the sediment itself on the bubble surface. So this was a continuous component, and the most difficult component for the modeling is the fracturing component. So this is the initial bubble front, just a line where you can see the contact of the bubble with the sediment. This is a head, and this is a front. And the fracturing will show you how this front evolves, how it propagates, and this is the reason how the bubble grows. So the rate of change of this line, of this front, will define you the boundary of this bubble, okay? And this is a discrete component, which is not so easy to implement. And it is solved with some classical fracture mechanical approach, which is named displacement extrapolation method, okay? So, and what we measure here is the component which will tell you if the bubble which will fracture is the stress intensity factor that I said you previously. that will indicate you a state of the front at each point and point of this front. Okay? So this is a model, and this is a model verification, the first verification, again without gravity. So this is the initial, for instance, bubble configuration when you have no gas. Actually, your surfaces are at zero distance from another, but just I draw it like that to see that there is just some initial bubble seed. And when you inflate your bubble and your pressure within your bubble is larger than the stress field around the sediment, then you will have some analytical solution for the opening of this bubble. So this opening is named COD, crack opening displacement. This is the analytical solution. And here you can see, for instance, along in the distance from the bubble center to its head, how this opening changes. And you see that there is a good agreement between the numerical and the analytical prediction. Okay. So, and here are the modeling results. First, I will show you just the bubble growth and the geochemical conditions were taken from the Eckenford Bay. At the NRL site, Eckenford Bay is the bay of the Baltic Sea, at the sediment at the depth of 1 meter. So, for instance, you can see this is the concentration of the dissolved methane. And we took a data from the for the initial bubble at 1 meter. This is just an example. For instance, in the small box, you see the displacement of the initial bubble. Okay, the first thing what we try to do, we try to simulate this typical pressure evolution pattern within the bubble. And you can see, actually, you see here this sawtooth pattern comparatively to that obtained in the experiment in the muddy sediment. Okay, so when the bubble absorbs methane from the ambient methane concentration field, you see that it expands, and then at some critical conditions, it fails by the fracturing. And then it again absorbs methane and again fails by the fracturing. Okay, and this is the first thing that we succeeded to do. And the second thing is we wanted to see with the gravity how this front evolves. That means how this bubble grows until its mature configuration. And you can see here that in its tail, the bubble actually grows with a constant increment, and as a bubble becomes larger, its increment at its tail, this is head and this is tail, subsides until zero. And when this increment, so it means that bubble grows mostly upward towards because of the gravity, towards the direction of the sediment water interface. And then the final configuration of the mature bubble is the inverted teardrop. So when you see that you get the configuration of the inverted teardrops, this is your final mature bubble that is ready to start migrating towards the sediment water interface. Okay. So, and here you can see the correlation of the bubble shape and size with mechanical properties and specifically with fracture toughness. I will remind you that fracture toughness, it just shows how the bonds between the grains are strong. So what you can see here is, this is a bubble front, the half of the bubble front, and this is the half of the bubble cross section in the shape of the inverted teardrop. Okay, this is mature bubble. What you also can see here is the analytic developed analytical and numerical solutions for different fracture toughness. For instance, this is for the smaller one, and this is for the largest one. Okay, and you can see that the shape and the size of these bubbles depend on how the sediment is strong. Okay, that means that in the weaker sediments, the bubbles are smaller and they are less inflated. They are quite flat. But in the stronger sediments, for instance, when there is a larger amount of the organic matter, the bubbles are much taller and they are also much more inflated. Okay? And we try to analyze. We try to analyze the dimensions and the shape of these bubbles with allometric scaling. Okay, that for instance here also these are the bubbles in the weak sediments and these are the bubbles in the strong sediments. And what you can see here, so you can see that bubble grows allometrically. And here is the isometric growth pattern. If the bubbles would grow isometrically, that means that its surface grows in the same measure as its volume, you will get this line. And here, if you are looking for this line and also for all other lines, you can see that the surface area of these bubbles grows much faster than its volume. Okay, and also you can see that smaller bubbles formed at the in the weaker sediments are characterized by the bigger surface to volume ratio than the larger bubbles in the stronger sediments, and that results in the increased sensitivity of the smaller bubbles to the ambient solution field, inducing faster growth of the smaller bubbles, and which can lead to their accelerated dissolution due to the metanotrophy below the sediment water interface. The last thing about the shape of the bubbles is the surface area ratio. Surface area ratio shows you how the shape of these bubbles deviate from the sphericity. Okay, so this is the surface of the actual bubble divided by the surface of the equivalent spherical bubble in the volume. So again, you can see that for the bubbles that formed in the weaker sediments, the shape of these bubbles is deviate much more from the spherical configuration than the shape of the bubbles formed in the stronger sediment, and this is of course very important for the acoustic applications. And also we compared the equivalent spherical radius of these bubbles because we took the mechanical conditions from the mass of the Zeckenfurth Bay, and we compared the dimensions of these bubbles to the actual bubbles formed in the Zeckenfurth Bay. And there you see here we have the equivalent spherical radius approximately from 1 to 5 millimeters, and also in the Zeckenfurth Bay we saw the range of this equivalent spherical radius also in the very close range from 0.4 to 5 millimeters. So the bubbles and the dimensions are very close. So this project was about just the growth of the bubble, and then we proceeded further with Shahrazad, okay? And she modeled the bubble propagation and tried to understand the controlling factor, okay? And what was modeled? We modeled two concentration profiles. The first one is the constant dissolved methane concentration profile as at 1 meter depth in the sediment of Zeckenfurth Bay. And the second one, which is this one, is a variable subsiding upward concentration profile, which is associated with biochemical reactions of dissolved methane consumption with methanotrophy. Okay, so you can see, for instance, that from here the methane concentration would be zero. Okay, and this is initially a bubble in the shape of the inverted teardrop. So this is just the initial conditions. Okay, what you can see here are the diffusing methane fluxes. Also in the case of the constant methane concentration and also in the variable concentration. Okay, you can see here that in a case with a constant concentration, the bubble propagated much larger distance than here. And also what is important, that you see that the bubble is in the specific stress field closed its tail. And this is actually only the opened part of this bubble. And you can see also that in this closed tail, the diffusive methane flux is zero, if you are looking for the color. So the bubble, this bubble, when it propagates, absorbs the methane only via its open active part. Okay, and what you also can see here, that when the bubble propagates towards the sediment water interface, it becomes much more inflated, it's opening much larger. Okay, the most important things is that actually this bubble ascent is controlled by the evolution of this parameter that I said you previously, that shows how the shows what is the stress field at the bubble, how it's close to the failure. Okay, if, and for instance here in this point, if this parameter which indicates your stress field is larger than the strength of the bond, this one, then the bubble migrates upward. And if it is smaller, then it becomes static. So in the bubble propagation, we saw two sequential propagation patterns. The first one is a stable propagation, which is characterized by sawtooth pattern that was in the simulations of the bubble growth. And the second one is the dynamic propagation pattern, which is this one, which can be approximated by the rising line pattern. So, and you see that we got these two patterns also in the variable concentration profile and also under the constant concentration profile. So if you are looking again on this sawtooth pattern, what you can see that when the bubble expands, it absorbs the solute, it expands, gains mechanical energy, and then, for instance, if you compare this parameter to the strength of the bonds, if it exceeds it, then your K drops down below the critical value. Okay, and it means that the propagation is arrested. So this bubble does not propagate without a bound. It is the propagation of this bubble is arrested. Okay, and if we go to the mechanics, okay, these two patterns are known patterns in the mechanics, in the pure mechanics. And then the crack propagation or the bubble propagation pattern remains stable as long as the mechanical energy gained by the system due to the elastic expansion is sufficient to generate only a new surface area of the growing pit. That means that the bubble absorbs methane, expands elastically more and more until it cracks. Okay? And when it cracks, it just generates a new surface, and the propagation is arrested. It is here. Okay? So, and we have a stable propagation. For instance, if we somehow avoid the absorption of methane, then the bubble, the stress field, and the K in the bubble will remain here. So, and this is the main feature of this propagation pattern. But in contrast, at the certain stage of the bubble ascent, propagation changes to the dynamic pattern, which is also a known pattern. And you see that nothing arrests the bubble propagation. And under these conditions, the bubble may freely propagate through the entire material domain and being released with high velocity from the sediment. And this is actually not what we see in the nature, because in most of the cases, especially in the sea, the bubbles stop at some distance below the sediment water interface because of the metanotrophy. So it is maybe under some conditions it can be seen in lacustrine environments that you have a very, very large evolution. But for instance, if you are looking in the Eckernförde Bay, the picture that I showed you in the beginning, you see that there is a well-defined gas horizon, the bubbles stop. And we don't see that the bubbles stop here. So we got back to the mechanics of the dynamic propagation pattern. Okay? So, and in this dynamic propagation pattern, the mechanical energy gained by the system due to the elastic expansion due to the absorption of methane exceeds that necessary to form the new surface area, and is transformed to the kinetic energy. That means that the expansion of the bubble is so large that it is not spent only to the fracturing, to the creation of the new surfaces, but this excess of the energy is transformed to the kinetic energy and the accelerated bubble propagation, which actually even does not depend on the ambient zero concentration profile. So, and we tried to analyze actually why we don't see that the bubble stops even under the zero concentration conditions. Again, when we go back to the mechanics, there can be just two points that can be responsible for this unbounded dynamic propagation. The first one, that even under constant stress field, the crack is so long that it reaches its critical length. It is not our case. But our case is when the applied loading is subjected to the rapid variations. And maybe I'll ask you, do you have an idea what is in our case the rapid variation? Okay, so I will proceed. So if we are talking about the buoyant bubble, this is a buoyant bubble in the shape of the inverted teardrop, rises towards the sediment water interface, stress component normal to the bubble surface subsides linearly with depth due to the gravity. That means that if you go from the current location of the bubble toward the sediment water interface, your ambient stress field will decrease linearly, right? Because of the gravity. You see, because you have a weight of the sediment column, and this weight will decrease linearly toward the sediment water interface. Okay, and as a result, the bubble would expand more and more. That means that it will gain an additional mechanical elastic energy. And this expansion would be so large, this mechanical energy would be so large that it will not only create the new crack surface, but will have an excess which will be transformed to the kinetic energy of the accelerated bubble propagation. This one. But still, under these conditions, the bubble may be released from the sediment with a high velocity, even in a case with zero ambient concentration field. But still, we got no answer why this bubble doesn't stop. Okay? So you can look here, for instance. This is the initial bubble, and here you see two bubbles, two coinciding profiles of the bubbles. The first one is the green one, is the bubble position at 17 seconds at the constant profile of non-zero profile concentration, and the same profile at 33 seconds at this variable concentration profile. And if you are again look at this profile, you see that this bubble entirely passed the non-zero concentration profile, and it's totally in zero concentration profile. Okay, that means that it should stop, but it doesn't stop. Okay, so and what could be the condition? So what is the reason that the bubble doesn't stop, that we can't reduce this large elastic expansion? It means that in general that the flux of methane from the bubble outward is insufficient. Okay, and then we can't reduce this elastic expansion. And in general, okay, what could be two conditions to decrease this flux? The first one is zero ambient methane, the small ambient concentration profile. So we already have zero concentration profile, and we can't do with that nothing, anything. And the bubble still propagates. And the other condition is the pressure within the bubble. Okay? And this pressure is responsible for the concentration of the methane on the bubble surface. So if you have a pressure within the bubble, so you have some specific gas concentration, and also according to the Henry law, you have some specific concentration of the dissolved methane. If the pressure is large, then you will have a large concentration of the dissolved methane that would significantly increase the bubble dissolution. That means that in our case, the pressure within the bubble is not enough. It is low enough. It is low in order to generate the dissolution. And that's why the bubble doesn't stop. So, and what could be the reasons for the large pressure within the bubble?
Regina?
Ken. The first one, then the bubble should be at much deeper location. And the second one, which is most important one, okay, that in general, in geotechnical approaches, the water loading is not taken as load because of the increase in the pore pressure, okay? And because we are dealing with muddy sediments, we think that this water column, which is 26 meters in the Eckenford Bay, should be taken into the account, in contrast with conventional geotechnical approaches, and considering, and this relies on the mechanical consideration of a muddy sediment, not like a porous, not as a porous media, but as a single combined solid media. And that pressure and this water load would generate the pressure that would be able to stop this bubble. So that's all in general. So I don't have time, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so any questions, please?
Thank you. Questions, yes, Eric.
I'm asking if bubbles tend to follow
form roots of bubbles that might fracture in the open and then they can go through. And in a larger scale, if we zoom out, if after bubbles go through, we maybe get any kind of a structure of the roots that the bubbles went through, and then we have kind of a small pore network inside the mud sediment.
In general, if you have a horizontal stress field, I had here a picture of your, when bubble migrate, it closes its tail. But it is completely closed, but there is still no healing, no cohesion. The cohesion between the broken cohesion does not heal immediately. It will take time when this cohesion will restore. But if you have, for instance, some wave loading ties or anything, then of course the adjacent bubble will find this not an L track to go through this way. Other questions?
Many questions, no time.
Okay.
Thank you.